I'd like to welcome everybody to today's legislative hearing. We are reviewing three bills, S-518, the Small and Rural Community Clean Water Technical Assistance Act, the Water Infrastructure Flexibility Act of 2017, and S-675, the Long Island Sound Restoration and Stewardship Act. The sponsors of these bills also sit on the Armed Services Committee, which has a conflicting meeting in just a few minutes. So what we'd like to do is go ahead and let them go first. I'm going to recognize Senator Wicker, Senator Fisher, and Senator Gillibrand to make remarks about their legislation. Then I will give my opening statement, followed by Ranking Member Duckworth, and then we'll proceed to the testimony. So if you'd like to start us out, Roger.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for accommodating our schedule this afternoon. I am here at this moment to talk about S-518, which deals with sewer systems that serve fewer than 10,000 people. And frankly, in the United States of America, some 80% of public sewer systems are in that category. Many of these small communities often face significant challenges in complying with federal rules, and of course, it's also costly. S-518 provides some relief in the form of technical assistance and training to assist small communities in securing the necessary technical expertise to improve and protect their water resources. Specifically under my legislation, the EPA administrator would have authority to direct funding to nonprofit organizations to provide on-site assistance, regional training, assistance with implementation of monitoring plans, rules, and regulations to ensure compliance with the Clean Water Act. I might mention to my colleagues that a similar initiative has already been in effect with regard to effective implementation of the Safe Drinking Water Act. So this would add the Clean Water Act to that. And I believe this program would share the same success for rural community wastewater systems. The bill would also do one other thing. It would allow states to use up to 2% of their Clean Water State Revolving Loan Fund for technical assistance for these small systems. My appreciation goes out to our colleague, Senator Heitkamp, for being the lead Democrat on this bill, and to members of this committee, Barrasso, Bozeman, and Capito, for also signing on as co-sponsors. There's a great need for this, and I urge its adoption at the appropriate time, and thank my colleagues for their attention.
Thank you. We thank the senator from Mississippi, and now we'll go to our senator from Nebraska.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and my thanks also to the ranking member for holding this hearing today. I thank the committee for coordinating the schedule with today's conflicting Armed Services Committee briefing. I would also like to thank Mayor Gray for providing testimony today on behalf of the U.S. Conference of Mayors and the other witnesses for their willingness to share their time and experience with our subcommittee. Last week, I introduced S-692, the Water Infrastructure Flexibility Act, with Senators Brown, Cardin, Bozeman, Portman, Blunt, and Booker. Our bipartisan legislation would provide local communities with increased flexibility when complying with Clean Water Act requirements for updates to water infrastructure projects. The bill would also give communities more independence as they prioritize and plan for wastewater and stormwater investments. More than 700 local communities across the country face mandates from the EPA to comply with Clean Water Act requirements. In my home state of Nebraska, the city of Omaha was hit with a $2 billion unfunded federal mandate from the EPA. Specifically, Omaha was required to update its combined sewer overflow system. We all want clean and safe drinking water, but an expensive one-size-fits-all approach handed down from Washington does not work. According to the U.S. Conference of Mayors, on average, municipalities spend between 6 to 7 cents of every tax dollar on water and sewer systems. This makes water infrastructure the third largest expense for cities after education and emergency personnel. Local communities that are forced to comply with these costly mandates have no choice but to pass these costs to families through their higher utility bills. For example, in 2014, the City Council in Omaha, Nebraska approved a sewer rate increase of approximately 45% over several years. This hurts the most vulnerable in the community, our low and fixed income families. The Water Infrastructure Flexibility Act would allow municipalities to prioritize investments in storm and wastewater projects needed for CWA compliance. It would also establish an Office of Municipal Ombudsman at the EPA to assist cities in complying with federal environmental laws. Most importantly, our bill requires the EPA to revise this regulation to make it more affordable. The U.S. Conference of Mayors, the National Association of Counties, the National League of Cities, and the National Association of Clean Water Agencies have all endorsed this bill, and I'm grateful for their support. I would ask unanimous consent that their letters of support be included in the record.
Without objection.
Thank you, sir. We all want clean water. Our bill helps us work for that important goal without unnecessarily burdening families along the way. I would like to thank my colleagues for joining me on this legislation, and I look forward to working with each of you as we move forward to address our nation's infrastructure needs. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Fisher, very much. We're going to have our opening statements. I'll speak first, and then our ranking member. And then if Senator Gillibrand pops in, we're going to pause because she also needs to be at Armed Services. So the reality is now we all have two or three things that are going on at the same time. There's lots going on up here. As a former member of the House Transportation Infrastructure Committee and now part of the Senate and Environment and Public Works Committee, I understand the importance of infrastructure investment. During my time in Congress, I've been a constant advocate for water resources development and infrastructure. In the 114th Congress, the Senate EPW and full Congress demonstrated its commitment to infrastructure with the bipartisan, and I emphasize bipartisan, passage of two bills, the Water Infrastructure Improvement for the Nation Act, as well as a comprehensive highway bill, the Fixing America's Surface Transportation Act, and I was very pleased to support both. Passing these pieces of legislation was a major step forward. However, there's still more to be done, and I'm looking forward to opportunities that we'll have to make investments in the 115th Congress, and really looking forward to working with Senator Duckworth in that capacity. Like many Americans, I'm encouraged by the Trump administration's commitment to improving our nation's crumbling infrastructure, following the example set by President Dwight Eisenhower in the establishment of the interstate highway system. It is clear that infrastructure investment boosts our economy, creates immediate jobs, and produces decades of economic opportunity. Unfortunately, since the President signed the Federal Aid Highway Act of 1956, we have relied on a fix-as-fail approach to our nation's infrastructure. Not only is the fix-as-fail approach more expensive, increasingly causing delays to commerce, but it also poses a risk to public safety. The United States faces a multi-hundred billion dollar shortfall for water infrastructure investments, which include drinking water, sewer, and water supply projects. This shortage is reflected in the American Society of Civil Engineers' overall grade for America's infrastructure as a D+. America is now at a crossroads. We need to address our aging infrastructure, but it comes with a cost. We have options that can help fund infrastructure projects so we can get shovels in the ground and projects underway. The federal government has provided funding to establish revolving loan grant programs administered by the states, as well as resources through the Water Infrastructure Finance and Innovation Act, WIFIA, this program leverages small investments to make sure that taxpayers get the most bang for the buck. However, solving America's infrastructure crisis is not just about funding. We also need to make investing in infrastructure more affordable. And once they have made investments, smaller communities may need technical assistance with operation and maintenance. And of course, planning is needed to help us make wise investments. One example of Congress providing these tools is the Water Supply Cost Savings Act, which I co-sponsored and was included in another bill. This legislation provides a technical clearinghouse and encourages cost-effective approaches new to bring affordable, quality drinking water to rural America, which is so, so very important. With this tool, we help to ensure that rural states such as Arkansas are not overburdened by major new infrastructure investments. The three bills that we are reviewing today provide further examples of how we can help communities meet the requirements of the Clean Water Act. We all want clean water, but communities are being asked to do more and more. And these requirements are all coming at once, where there are mandates to update treatment plants to address nutrients, mandates to control stormwater flows, or mandates to address combined or sanitary sewer overflows. Lots of unfunded mandates. The question is not whether a community is going to address these issues. However, we have to recognize that there are limits to how fast a community can act, particularly when meeting clean water mandates that can cost hundreds of millions, and in some cases, billions of dollars. Senator Fisher's bill, the Water Infrastructure Flexibility Act of 2017, helps address this issue. This legislation, which I'm also co-sponsoring, allows communities to put all their Clean Water Act obligations into a single plan and then implement that plan over time, making the investments that provide the greatest environmental and economic benefits first, instead of trying to do everything at once. Another issue is whether a community has the technical capability to meet Clean Water Act mandates. Many wastewater treatment systems operated by small and rural communities have few staff and limited resources. As a result, they may lack the expertise to maintain compliance with Clean Water Act requirements and may not be able to afford a full-time technical expert. On-site technical assistance and education offered by circuit riders provides a cost-effective way to address this issue. Senator Wicker's bill, the Small and Rural Community Clean Water Technical Assistance Act, addresses this issue by authorizing funding for rural water circuit riders. Under this bill, which I'm also a co-sponsor, funding for this program can come directly from EPA. In addition, the bill also allows states to set aside a part of their state revolving loan funds money for this purpose. Finally, we want to know that which are the wisest investments we can make to achieve clean water. Senator Gillibrand's bill, the Long Island Sound Restoration and Stewardship Act, addresses this issue for the waters of Long Island. This bill reauthorizes two existing programs that help New York and Connecticut develop, adapt, and implement the Long Island Sound Comprehensive Conservation and Management Bill and help to restore the coastal habitat. I look forward to hearing the views of our witnesses on these bills and how we can promote flexibility, technical assistance, and good planning. I now recognize Senator Duckworth for our opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, everyone. And of course, thank you to Chairman Bozeman for convening this important conversation and to all of our witnesses for joining us today. Welcome to rainy D.C., where the cherry blossoms are not as in bloom as we'd like, but still lovely nonetheless. I believe that infrastructure issues broadly can be a bright spot of bipartisanship for this subcommittee and our full committee, as well as Congress. Whether it's rural areas or urban areas, a coastal or a plains state, communities across this country are grappling with finding ways to provide infrastructure that is strong and safe. Not only are there challenges all across this country, these challenges are often similar. They also have a pressing need to prioritize this issue now all across the nation. As we discuss three bills before us today, I'd like to highlight that each bill in its own way addresses issues I hear so many communities in Illinois complaining about. They provide communities with the capacity that they need to take care of themselves and their residents. The Water Infrastructure Flexibility Act will supply local governments the technical capacity so that they may better comply with requirements under the Clean Water Act. The Small and Rural Community Clean Water Technical Assistance Act has a similar objective. In this bill, we provide small communities the workforce capacity they wouldn't otherwise have access to. Finally, everyone should support programs like the Long Island Sound Restoration and Stewardship Act, which will give the region capacity to coordinate restoration activities with other federal activities. Clearly, capacity can come in different shapes and sizes, but regardless of the form, the returns are substantial and in some cases critical. I am excited to work with all of you and hope that our hearing today will be the first of many to come where we will come together, hear ideas, and consider solutions to these very urgent issues. Thank you again, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Senator Gillibrand.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Madam Ranking Member. I'm very grateful for this subcommittee hearing today and for including my bill, the Long Island Sound Restoration and Stewardship Act, on the agenda today. I would like to welcome my friend, Erin Crotty, and thank her for her testimony today. We went to high school together. Erin is the executive director of Audubon New York and a former commissioner of the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. Audubon New York has been an important partner in protecting the Long Island Sound, and I'm so pleased Erin could be here today to give the perspective of those who work on the ground every day and see the benefits of federal investment in restoring the sound. Thank you, Erin, for being here and for traveling from New York. Mr. Chairman, the legislation I reintroduced this Congress, along with Senators Blumenthal, Schumer, and Murphy, is identical to the bills that have unanimously passed this committee in previous Congresses. It has strong bipartisan support from the New York and Connecticut delegations in the House, as well as from the local communities in Long Island Sound watershed. The Long Island Sound is an estuary of national significance that contributes up to $37 billion to the regional economy each year. To protect this resource, my legislation would reauthorize through fiscal year 2023 our federal commitment to helping our communities in New York and Connecticut restore and maintain the health of Long Island Sound and its ecosystems. For every $1 in federal funds appropriated to the Long Island Sound program, an additional $87 is leveraged from other sources. We've seen the results of our investment. Federal funding has already helped us significantly reduce by millions of pounds the amounts of nitrogen entering the sound from sewage treatment plants. We've protected thousands of acres of habitat land, but there is still work to be done to reduce pollution and protect vital ecosystems in and around the sound for millions of my constituents who live and work near it and want to enjoy its natural resources for recreation. I thank the committee for once again considering this legislation and hope that we can move quickly through Congress so that we can get it to the President's desk. Thank you both.
Thank you, and let's go to our witnesses now. Mr. Gray.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. My name's Rick Gray. I'm the mayor of the city of Lancaster, Pennsylvania, a city of 60,000 people and 7 square miles. The Water Infrastructure Flexibility Act is a positive step in acknowledging that we need to approach our water and wastewater issues in a more practical and cost-effective manner. Attached to my testimony is a letter signed by the U.S. Conference of Mayors, the National League of Cities, and the National Association of Counties that encourages all senators to co-sponsor this legislation. During intense rainstorms due to impervious surfaces and our combined stormwater wastewater system, millions of gallons of untreated wastewater can be caused to overflow into our river. The city has been proactively implementing comprehensive stormwater program to improve water quality, meet regulatory compliance, and address stormwater challenges using gray as well as green infrastructure. Since 1999, the City of Lancaster has been implementing a state-approved long-term control plan, investing $80 million in gray infrastructure improvements. We are close to meeting the 85% capture goal set forth by EPA. If Lancaster used gray infrastructure, this remaining 15% would cost an estimated $300 million. After more than a year of evaluation and many public input sessions, Lancaster determined that a $140 million investment in green infrastructure with other gray system improvements over the next 25 years could accomplish the remaining compliance for the system. So in 2011, Lancaster adopted a green infrastructure program, establishing an integrated stormwater management to reduce combined sewerage overflows in a more cost-effective and environmentally sustainable manner. Lancaster has completed 45 green infrastructure programs at a cost of over $10 million. This has resulted in the capture of 45 million gallons of stormwater annually. EPA Region 3 and EPA headquarters has lauded our program and held Lancaster up as a model for other cities to replicate. Yet EPA's enforcement division continues aggressive actions, including threats of civil penalties in the seven-figure range, to press us to use costly gray technology rather than allowing Lancaster time to implement a more sustainable green solution. Lancaster's story indicates or illustrates that a new direction for EPA is necessary, one that will allow cities the flexibility to opt for more sustainable and resilient green infrastructure technologies. Since the beginning of Lancaster's implementation, we have had significant rate increases, and I believe they were 130% since 2003, plus a stormwater fee. Rate increases for our customers that disproportionately affect the disadvantaged populations of our community. This is in a community which 29% of our households have incomes of less than $20,000. These problems are shared by many cities. The mayor's message to Congress is that renewing the public water infrastructure and delivering safe water is becoming less affordable, and sewer and stormwater mandates are expensive and may not address the highest local, environmental, or public health concerns of a city. I'd like to call your attention to four points that are important to the nation's mayors. One, codify EPA's integrated planning and permitting policy. Integrating planning should be designed to allow cities to develop comprehensive plans and establish a plan of investment over time to reach these goals. Achieving long-term control of stormwater through permits. We urge Congress to create a path of long-term goals that exist through the permitting process rather than by way of consent decrees. Three, renew congressional support for exercising flexibility in existing clean water law. And four, eliminate civil fines in consent decrees for local governments that develop integrated plans and make reasonable progress in improving their waters. I wish to thank the committee for this opportunity to speak before them today. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony, and I didn't go to school with him, but I do want to especially thank Dennis Sternberg for being here from Greenbrier, Arkansas. I've had the opportunity to work with him for the last several years, and he does a tremendous job. As of January 2017, Mr. Sternberg has spent 38 years in the water and wastewater industry in Arkansas, 29 of those years spent working in almost all field positions as a field rep, EPA program manager, USDA circuit rider, and wastewater technician trainer. He and his Rural Water Association staff are committed to the future of rural communities by assisting utilities throughout the state with their many challenges that rural small utilities continue to face. He holds the highest and water and wastewater licenses in Arkansas. In 2006, he received the Executive Director of the Year Award from the National Rural Association. And in 2009, United States Department of Agriculture National Rural Water Association recognized Dennis for leadership and emergency response preparation. So thank you for many, many years of service to the people of Arkansas. And now you can give your testimony.
Thank you, Senator. Good afternoon, Chairman Bozeman and members of the committee. It's an honor to be here, and we are grateful that you have included a voice of rural America at this hearing. My name is Dennis Sternberg, and I'm the executive director of Arkansas Rural Water Association, a nonprofit association of 563 small and rural community water utilities in Arkansas. I'm also a representative of the National Rural Water Association, which has over 31,000 community members. Our mission is to enhance the water service, safety, compliance, and quality in small and rural America. My main message to the committee today is that the small and rural communities in all states strongly support S-518, the Small and Rural Community Clean Water Technical Assistance Act. And we urge the committee and the Senate to pass it as soon as possible to help small communities with the operation of their wastewater utilities and compliance with the federal regulations of the Clean Water Act. We are very appreciative of Senator Wicker and Heitkamp's sponsorship of the bill, and I will explain why this legislation and help is helpful and merits enactment. Most all of the country's sewer systems or wastewater utilities are small. Approximately 80% of the country's 16,000 wastewater utilities serve a population fewer than 10,000. In Arkansas, for example, approximately 340 of the 370 community wastewater utilities serve small communities. In Illinois, it's approximately 700 of the 800. In Maryland, it's 130 of the 170. And in Mississippi, it's approximately 270 of the 300. Small and rural communities have more difficulty affording public wastewater service due to the lack of population density and lack of economies of scales. This challenge is compounded by the fact that rural communities have lower average medium household incomes and often have higher rates of poverty. Likewise, we have a much more challenging time complying with the Federal Clean Water Act, the permits and operating complex wastewater treatment systems due to the lack of technical resources in small communities. While we have fewer resources, we are regulated in the exact same manner as a large community. S-518 provides a solution to the lack of technical resources in small communities by providing technical experts, we call them circuit riders, in each state to be shared by all small rural communities who are in need of assistance. A circuit rider is a person with expertise in wastewater treatment, operation, maintenance, governance, and compliance who constantly travels the state to be available on-site to any community in need of assistance. For these circuit riders to be effective and helpful, they must be available to travel directly to any community to work specifically with the community's leaders, with their unique treatment, and personally educate that operator, mayor, or other local officials on how to solve their problems. They have to be available when the community needs them to help with, which could happen at nights, winters, after natural disasters, weekends. Also, they must be non-regulatory to gain the trust of the local communities. The small town of Kinsett, Arkansas, provides a good recent example of technical assistance. Last year, Kinsett Water Works called for help with their sewer system concerning a problem with their activated sludge plant. The plant had suddenly become upset and were out of compliance. A rural water circuit rider was dispatched and traveled to the community and inspected the plant and their records and noticed a decline in the sample results over a four-month period. The circuit rider disassembled the activated sludge return pump and lines to clean them and found the cause of the problem. The line had been blocked with biological growth. After clearing the lines and pumps, the circuit rider recommended they feed some artificial enzymes and some food supplements to try to jumpstart the recovery of the activated sludge plant. In addition to providing the technical solution to their problem, this assistance saved the community approximately $1,000 per day in potential fines. If enacted and appropriated, S-518 would allow for thousands of similar assistance events each year throughout the nation. Senator Wicker had a similar bill passed about a year ago to provide small communities with circuit rider assistance for the Safe Drinking Water Act and water treatment utilities. However, we have not been able to have that legislation, Public Law 114-98, specifically cited in EPA's appropriations bill, which is preventing that technical assistance funding from reaching rural Arkansas, Mississippi, Illinois, Maryland, and other states. Any assistance you can provide to correct these issues with EPA Appropriations Subcommittee is greatly appreciated. This committee is very important to rural and small town America. We're grateful for the opportunity to testify today and grateful for the numerous opportunities this committee has provided rural America to testify and be included in crafting of the federal water and environmental legislation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. Crotty, you're welcome to go now. I'll give you some extra time if you'd like to tell some stories about Senator Gillibrand.
I think I'll take a pass on that, Senator. Good afternoon, Senator Bozeman, Ranking Member Duckworth, and Senator Gillibrand. I really want to thank you for allowing me to testify on Senate Bill 675, the Long Island Sound Restoration and Stewardship Act. I would especially like to thank Senator Gillibrand from my home state for being a champion for the shared environment and for sponsoring this critically important legislation. So my name's Erin Crotty. I'm the executive director for Audubon New York. I'm also a vice president of the National Audubon Society. And our mission is to protect birds and their habitats, the places they need to survive throughout their entire life cycle. For decades, Audubon's united network of members, volunteers, chapters, national, New York State, Connecticut offices have worked hard to protect and restore Long Island Sound and its watershed. And here's why. Long Island Sound is a globally significant ecosystem for birds, fish, and other wildlife. It is a 1,320 square mile estuary of the Atlantic Ocean and borders 600 miles of New York and Connecticut. The Sound supports 54 important bird areas, which are the most important places for birds, 14 of which are globally important. It's an estuary of national significance, and the Sound is home to one of the most important tern nesting sites on Earth, Great Gull Island, with approximately 10,000 pairs of common terns and more than 1,000 pairs of the federally endangered roseate tern. The Sound supports over 1,200 species of invertebrates, 170 species of fish, and dozens of species of migratory birds, including the federally threatened piping plover and red knot. 23 million people, 7% of the U.S. population, live within 50 miles of the Sound, and it's 5 miles from the heart of the country's most populated city, New York. The Sound generates an impressive $9.4 billion annually to the regional economy. It's for these reasons that Audubon strongly supports the Long Island Sound Restoration and Stewardship Act. The Act authorizes the Long Island Sound Program and EPA and the Long Island Stewardship Act through fiscal year 2023. The Act authorizes up to $40 million annually for grants to support the Sound's Comprehensive Conservation Management Plan and up to $25 million annually to procure and enhance sites within the Sound's watershed, and adds critical functions to the Long Island Sound Study Office, including to study environmental impacts on the Sound source waters. The Act is a common sense approach to modern estuary protection and helps meet the federal government's share of the funding needed. The federal funding, which is often the driver for projects moving forward, will be leveraged with other federal, state, local, and private investment. On average, the estuaries of the National Estuary Program, of which the Long Island Sound Study is one, raises $18 for every dollar provided by EPA. That is a significant and meaningful leverage ratio. While the health of the Sound has improved, threats do continue. For nearly 30 years, this comprehensive effort has resulted in measurable improvement in the Sound's health, and Audubon has been there every step of the way. Water quality has improved, habitat has been restored, and open spaces protected, which has resulted in the Sound teeming with wildlife and people. Yet nitrogen is being reduced from wastewater treatment plants, habitat is being restored, millions of people are being engaged, and dead zones are shrinking. Bald eagles are nesting, and species are returning, like the humpback whales and bluefish. Yet the health of the Sound is still threatened, and today's threats are more diffuse and challenging. A changing climate, extreme weather events, acidification, nitrogen discharges from stormwater and septics, aging and broken infrastructure, brown tide, invasive species, development pressure, and rising sea levels are literally squeezing out the habitat for birds and other wildlife. These are the challenges facing the Sound today. The collaborative and integrated effort enabled by the Act is more important than ever. The Sound CCMP was updated in 2015, and the vision is one of clean water that's protected and nourished, abundant and diverse wildlife, flourishing commercial fisheries, accessible harbors, and a public that protects and sustains the ecosystem. The Act helps us, governments at all levels, the private sector, non-governmental organizations, including Audubon, and the public, reach that vision. The nation's national estuary program faces an uncertain future. The Trump administration has reportedly proposed to eliminate funding for EPA's categorical grants, which Audubon believes includes the 28 estuaries of the NEP, including the Sound. The NEP is a cost-effective, non-regulatory program that harnesses the power of on-the-ground stakeholders by providing them with a structure to collaborate, develop, and implement a long-term plan to guide their efforts. Over one half of our country's population lives within 100 miles of coasts, and more people are moving there. With a leverage ratio of 18 to 1 and $4.2 billion leveraged with an investment of $230 million in EPA grants, the NEP has proven to be a highly effective and efficient program. Audubon strongly encourages Congress to resist the short-sighted effort to cut the program. Thank you very much for the opportunity to testify today. Help us make a difference for the birds, the wildlife, and the people that rely on the Sound for survival and a high quality of life by taking action on Senate Bill 675, the Long Island Sound Restoration and Stewardship Act. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Crotty. Senator Gillibrand.
Thank you so much, Ms. Crotty, for your testimony. Two basic questions. Can you tell the committee and for the record what would be the environmental and economic impact if Congress no longer funded the Long Island Sound program? And can you describe more fully the level of coordination between the federal government and state, local, and NGO stakeholders to carry out projects to restore and protect the Sound? And I ask this because that leverage is really significant. So I think it's important for the federal government to know that it's not just federal dollars that are at stake here. It's a lot of other dollars that come because of federal leadership.
Right. So thank you, Senator. The Long Island Sound Study Program of EPA really is the linchpin or the catalyst, if you will, of pulling all of the parties who are working on restoring Long Island Sound, which is a bi-state effort, involves all the levels of government and certainly not-for-profit organizations and municipalities. I mean, it really is that glue that holds us together, and working towards a common vision in the CCMPs in order to protect and restore this estuary of national significance. The money we find from the Long Island Sound Program is often the catalyst for a project to move forward. All of these programs are co-funded. It's very rare when you have a wastewater treatment plant upgrade or habitat restoration project or an open space project that isn't leveraged with private dollars and public dollars. And so it would be extremely detrimental to the progress that we've made and certainly all of the challenges that we have left if the reauthorization didn't happen. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to ask Mr. Gray a question, and I'd like for you to respond also, Ms. Crotty, in the sense that it's going to be about green. And so, Mayor Gray, according to your testimony, it cost the city of Lancaster $80 million to capture 85% of flows from your combined sewers, but capturing the remaining 15%, I assume because the technology gets difficult, you know, to do that. And in many cases, I know in Arkansas we have situations where that happens, but there's really no measurable difference as far as the, you know, the streams and things like that. So that little extra is costing you so much, $300 million. So to me, it's just a classic example of the diminishing returns that you get at some point. And I don't really know where that's at, but at some point you get really diminishing returns. It also points out the need to try new approaches, you know, which you're doing, and have gotten a lot of credit for it, and yet you really don't get credit for it when it comes as far as enforcement. Tell me about the barriers that you faced to using green infrastructure approach, and then, Ms. Crotty, again, you know, the potential of having a portion of $300 million in green, that's a lot of green, and, you know, if that would be beneficial or not beneficial, trying to figure out kind of a common sense approach with these things. Yes, sir.
Well, Senator, all politics are local, and what we've done in Lancaster, we've combined green infrastructure with park improvement, with intersection improvement, with private alley improvement. We've funded through a state revolving fund loan that we got many demonstration projects on the local level. What's happened in doing that, when we do a park, for example, and put green infrastructure in, we have One park with six basketball courts, all with drain fields underneath them, all of which are impervious. When we do those types of projects, the people in Lancaster, and they know the neighborhood. They know the improvements that have been done in their neighborhood. It becomes a cost-effective problem at a certain point. How are we going to pay for this? Well, after 3 or 4 years of doing improvements, green infrastructure improvements, with visible side benefits, the public was ready and we imposed a stormwater fee. Now, you would think that the people would be up in arms with a stormwater fee, but people related to it as visible improvements in their neighborhood, their parks, their streets, their intersections, the rain gardens that we've put all over the city. They've seen visible improvements, which with infrastructure, very often you can't see what's being done. When it came time to impose a stormwater fee to pay for a lot of this, two people showed up at city council to oppose it. Lawyers for the two biggest parking lots in the city. The residents were ready to say, we're willing to do our part. So through a little creative politics over a 3 or 4 year period, the people in the community actually bought into it and actually were agreeable to doing it. The problem with the gray infrastructure, the cost of the gray infrastructure, is they want it done now. It must be done immediately. You have to put in a holding tank. You have to put in two holding tanks at $300 million. As compared to green infrastructure, which takes time to put in and time for its benefits to be realized. So the sense of urgency, I think, is one of the biggest problems, the sense of urgency imposed upon us.
Ms. Crotty.
Thanks, Senator. I think that that example is quite fascinating. You know, and I think that what we have found all across New York State, and particularly on Long Island, is when you have the ability to be flexible and devise local smart solutions from the start, that's sort of the best outcome. You know, being able to integrate green infrastructure, resiliency design into clean water infrastructure projects that are funded by multiple parties, including the state and federal governments. I mean, that's sort of the best solution. So making sure that the various regulatory statutes build into them and regulations, build into them the kind of flexibility that localities need in order to comply. You know, what you just described is a real quality of life issue, right? So the green infrastructure and resiliency components built into some of these local projects become a really important part of the quality of life of their community. It makes it nicer, it makes it more accessible, and it also improves the environment. So you definitely have had two big wins there in terms of your public policy priorities.
Senator Duckworth.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Sternberg, I understand that the Trump administration has promised eliminating a key program for rural communities, the USDA's Water and Waste Disposal Loan and Grant Program. I have 776 small and rural communities throughout my state that serve 1.4 million customers. I'm hearing from them that without this program, their ability to guarantee public sewer and wastewater systems will be impaired. Can you share with me how important a program like the Water and Waste Disposal Loan Grant Program is to small and rural communities?
Thank you, Senator. That's a very good question. And it's the same thing in Arkansas. You know, we have 700 community water systems, 370 wastewater systems. The majority of the systems in Arkansas and most states are that 31,000 community water systems that represent national rural water across the nation. Small rural communities go to the USDA loan grant program for their improvements or upgrades. That's been happening for over 70 years. That's the best program out there. It doesn't cost the federal government anything because they pay back. They have less than 0.5% delinquency rate. That type of program we need. That's infrastructure that we're going to continually need. For that system to go out on the private market is not going to be the same cost back to the ratepayers. It'll be absorbent. There's only so much money in the SRF, State Revolving Loan Fund. In Arkansas, the majority of the larger systems are accessing that. So the competition is going to be greater.
So am I correct in saying that the bills that we're talking about today might be supplemental, but certainly cannot take over the function of this program?
Oh, exactly. No.
Thank you. So, you know, can you share with me why technical assistance is also very important to rural communities and how technical assistance authorized in the Wicker bill would work in partnership with other programs?
You bet. The technical assistance for the small and rural communities, the 10,000 population and under, they're the ones that don't have the expertise, like the Little Rocks, the Jonesboros, where they have engineers and chemists and different ones available and licensed operator at the highest level to troubleshoot those type of things. They rely on rural water. Rural water has these technicians out there right now through USDA. We have some contracts through EPA, and we have some through our state SRF on the drinking water side. But they're designated to certain systems. There will be no duplication, and it's needed, drastically needed. There's more and more. We train more water and wastewater operators in the state of Arkansas than any other agency, including the primacy agency.
My goodness, thank you. You know, I tried getting bifocals, and they just... It looked like this table underneath me was curved, and they made me dizzy, so excuse me while I do this.
I'm an optometrist, so I'll give you some.
Would you please? Would you please? Because I got a pair, my first pair, and they just drive me crazy. Mr. Chairman, I would like to enter, ask unanimous consent to enter into the record. I have three letters here in support of the USDA Water and Waste Disposal Loan and Grant Program, as well as the Water Infrastructure Flexibility Act.
Yeah, without objection.
Thank you so much. As I mentioned in my opening remark, while I support all these bills, I think there's always room for improvements. For example, I'd like to work with all of you in making sure many of the communities in my state that are medium-sized are not left out. Mr. Mayor Gray, the city of Lancaster has long been working on a green infrastructure plan since 2011, as you were talking about. Can you share some of the primary and secondary benefits of using green infrastructure to address stormwater and wastewater projects?
Certainly, Senator. There's been three categories of improvements that we've seen. Environmental benefits, which include recharging groundwater, protecting and improving water quality, providing natural stormwater management, mitigating the heat island effect, and reducing energy use, all come from our green infrastructure programs. Social benefits, increasing recreational opportunities, improving health through cleaner air and water, and improved psychological well-being. Plus, it makes the city more attractive to the kind of people you want in the city, the millennials. A week doesn't go by when I'm not stopped by some younger person who tells me they like that the city prides itself on being a green city. They like it. They want to move there. They want to be part of it. Finally, the economic benefits, the future costs associated with stormwater management, as well as increasing property values. And I'll give you an example. We have a lot of private alleys in Lancaster, which are just what they sound like, alleys owned by the property owners on both sides. We put in a green alley in one of these private alleys. Within a week, the price of the house that was for sale on the green alley had gone up $2,500, and there was a little annotation in the newspaper advertising it as being on, quote, the green alley. Now, they're all over the city now, yet we find people that are willing to part with their own money, $500 a property owner, to put these types of things in. So there's so many benefits that come from it that are just past stormwater benefits. Again, environmental, social, and economic benefits all come from green infrastructure.
Thank you. I always find my mayors to be the most practical of problem solvers, and I think you've just demonstrated that in your answer.
We have to be, Senator.
You do. You do. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. The senator from Nebraska.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mayor Gray, since you just received that great compliment from the ranking member, I have a question for you. In your written testimony, you mentioned that the current EPA enforcement approach employs aggressive actions, rigid methods, and threats of large civil penalties. So what are the consequences for such an approach for small cities like Lancaster?
Well, we have one consent decree we're operating under already from American Disability Act. My predecessor was sued, and rightfully so, they entered into a consent decree. Now for everything we do with our sidewalks and our streets, we have to go to Philadelphia and get approval from a federal judge who's very nice and sympathetic, but it's taken it out of our hands. The practical things have been taken out of our hands. We met with the EPA, and the EPA region was very supportive of our green infrastructure program. Politically, I sold it to people. We got to get ahead of the EPA. We want to do this before they make us do things. We want to be positive about it. We want to be friends with the EPA. We want them to be our friends. They supported us for years. And if you went to a Chesapeake Bay meeting, and they were having a slideshow, there'd always be a couple of slides that the EPA would put up about Lancaster. This is what we want. This is what we want you to do. Then a few years ago, enforcement got involved. And I'm not sure the region and the enforcement division talked to each other, because it was a totally different attitude. It was, you know, you have to do this. It must be done now. Now, negotiations have proceeded, which are quite costly to the city, between experts and lawyers and whatnot. We spent a lot of money at this point talking with the EPA. We're trying to work something with them, but, for example, to impose a civil penalty, I'm not going to pay it. I was in private practice, you know, I represented clients who had civil penalties that came off their bottom line. Where does the civil penalty in the city of Lancaster come from but out of the taxpayers' pocket?
Right.
So we're negotiating with them right now. It sort of shocked us when they came with that kind of attitude, because we thought we had a different relationship with them.
My apologies, I gave your city the Nebraska pronunciation of Lancaster instead of Lancaster.
You're forgiven, son.
How would provisions within the Water Infrastructure Flexibility Act help to give cities and counties a stronger seat at the table in addressing these, really the long-term strategic water infrastructure needs that you have? You said trying to work with EPA and really redevelop a good working relationship. Do you think my bill would help with that?
Absolutely, and we think we do have a good working relationship with one part of the EPA. We support their goals and we support their efforts. The bill has a couple of things in it that would really be different and change the culture. The permitting, to have permitting and including this all in permitting rather than do it through a consent decree that is a 20-year decree. Do it for 5 years, look at it, work together on it, see what your abilities are. The provisions in there for affordability. Again, the city of Lancaster has 29% of its families that have $20,000 or less income. Affordability is an important issue to us. We want to do it. We want to do it right. How much can we afford for it? Finally, the provision that you take the civil penalties out, that's another approach. That why not use that money to implement green infrastructure or gray infrastructure? Why penalize us for what's happened in the past?
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned how under the current structure that cities are faced with need to increase rates on the families and with a regressive impact on those most in need or on a fixed income. I'm concerned about that as well. And a 2% increase on utility rates means a great deal for working families. Can you explain why the median household income benchmark is harmful to low and fixed income families?
Well, not really. Can you guys give me a hand?
Any other panel members wish to address that?
Well, all I'd say on that is, Senator, the medium household income for that city or area, you still have the lower income people that's going to be affected through it all. And in similar situations through Arkansas, we have that same problem. So you set it at the medium household income, so the lower income people are still getting hit harder because of their poverty or whatever the case might be for the unique. And it's something that really needs a hard look at.
Again, 29% of our population makes less than $20,000 per year. We had estimated that if you did that, it would be around $700 a year, I think. Is that around $700 a year for water? Right now in the city of Lancaster, you might pay $200 a year. Mm-hmm. So it would impact the low-income and moderate-income people. That would be a substantial increase.
Right. And that's what we're trying to address in the bill, to make sure that those people that are on low income or have fixed incomes aren't hurt disproportionately by the legislation that we're putting forward, and we're still able to make sure that those water infrastructure projects are going to get done. So thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator.
Senator Cardin.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank the witnesses for being here and sort of share a story. I was helping a local councilman from Baltimore City during the elections this year. So I did something that senators don't normally do. I was going actually knocking door to door for this candidate. I was not on the ballot in Baltimore City. And there was a theme on every person who opened up, who answered the door, and that was the water bills in Baltimore. And the affordability to the ratepayers. And I recognize that we have a real problem, and that is you have an aged water system that needs desperate repair, that costs a lot of money, that has yet to be fully implemented. Certainly in Baltimore City it hasn't been fully implemented. And you have the pressure on the ratepayers that is beyond their affordability. And we have to figure out a way to deal with this real problem that's in our community. And I thank the chairman for his leadership on this issue. The two of us have joined together on several initiatives to try to deal with water issues. And I know I'm working now with Senator Fisher and Brown on a bill that would make, we think, the water more affordable by integrated planning process, so that we require a lot of different plans. If we integrate it together, we can save considerable resources for local governments and, by the way, take a more holistic approach rather than taking a look at the specific program. So we're hoping that that will help deal with some of the affordability issues. We're also looking at the medium income standard for federal assistance. And it's interesting, Mr. Chairman, I'm going to share this with you. I got the numbers from Baltimore City because I found that they were kind of shocking. Baltimore City shows a relatively high medium income, but when you take a look at the poverty levels in Baltimore City, we have a large number of people, majorities that fall under the poverty level. So the medium income as the sole indicator for eligibility, we think is just the wrong approach. So we're offering those suggestions in an effort to try to make the federal partnership more available, particularly to those jurisdictions that are really being stressed on their ratepayers. I wanted to make those comments and thank you for the hearing. I'd be happy to hear from any of our witnesses who would like to respond as to other ways we can provide relief to the ratepayers and still get the type of modernization of our water infrastructure that is desperately needed, particularly in our older communities.
I just say, Senator, as far as rural and small communities, that's why it's so important what Senator Duckworth brought up about the USDA loan and grant program. If it goes away, water rates will go up in rural America and small. There's no way around it. And you hit on the larger systems having the same issue. I think Congress is doing something, starting something with the WIFIA program, funding some of that for the larger utilities. I think that's great. But you're right. You got to be we're going to have to be more inventive on how we go about doing things like that. But the USDA loan and grant program for infrastructure is vital. It's got to be put back in place.
I strongly support WIFIA. It was an initiative came out of this committee, and I support it. It doesn't take away, though, the need for us to have the basic partnership programs that help in regards to water infrastructure.
Yes, thank you, Senator. I was going to mention that under the Clean Water State Revolving Fund model, having the ability to give hardship grants and grants to municipalities can be very critical in times. The other thing I was going to mention was Senator Bozeman raised the prospects of having a large infrastructure investment coming out of Congress this year potentially, and if having clean water as part of that larger bill I think would be a tremendous investment in not only jobs and our economy, but also, you know, a benefit to our environment and our high quality of life. But we do find in New York State that sometimes the grant money that doesn't have to get paid back. You know, it's not the long-term interest loan or the low-interest long-term loan, but actual grants, that having the flexibility to be able to give out the grant money becomes a really critical point for some of the projects in rural parts of the state and areas that are less affluent.
I would point out that you're correct. There is strong interest in an infrastructure bill. It's going to be more difficult to deliver than just interest because we have to come together. What we urge you all to do, and you're going to have our support, is that whatever infrastructure bill comes out, make sure water is included in it. And that's not a foregone conclusion, because the interest on things that you see more visibly, like roads and bridges, are usually get more attention than things that are underground that people don't see and recognize the desperate need. Mr. Chairman, I have a letter from Baltimore City. I would just ask to be made part of a record.
Without objection. Let me just ask Mr. Sternberg a couple just quick questions. Can you explain to the committee why circuit riders that actually come to your community are more effective in providing technical assistance than other approaches like webinars? And in follow-up, has EPA shifted support for rural technical assistance away from the circuit riders, in your experience?
Well, the first part of it is the reason for the circuit riders and the need to go to the local communities versus the webinars. You're one-on-one with that operator, that mayor, and that council. You can show them their actual problem with their system. In a classroom or a webinar, you're just seeing different portions and functions of treatment plants, and there's no trust there. You're just reading something, hearing something. When you're with those circuit riders are there, you build that bond, that trust. And the next issue comes up along with that utility, they'll call them, and they'll call them quickly. That's the reason for the circuit riders, and you share that cost across all the small and rural communities. It's not just one engineer coming out there that costs that system to come up with a solution to it. So that's where the circuit riders are so vital to all this project. As far as the EPA, we have lost funding through EPA on our water technicians. We back in 2009, we had a groundwater technician fully funded, and that runs about $110,000 a year, I think it was. To now, our trainer that was fully funded back then, we're subsidizing that by about 45%. We don't get the money from them because they've spread the cost out to the webinars, to different things like that. There's nobody going on site like the circuit riders. That's where it happens. The rubber meets the road. I mean, that's where it's at.
You mentioned in your testimony about the circuit riders providing emergency response. Can you give some examples of that? And is anyone else out there providing that type of assistance?
In Arkansas, we're very proud of what we do in Arkansas Rural Water. We actually have 7 big mobile generators we can deploy. The example would be April the 27th, my birthday, in 2014, the tornadoes come through, hit Mayflower, Arkansas, hit Valonia, Arkansas. It was an F4, demolished the towns, both communities. I wasn't actually in state at the time. My staff called me. I said, deploy whatever assistance they need. Find out and identify what they need. Within 24 hours, we had every water system, the two water and wastewater system in Mayflower, the water and wastewater system in Valonia, up and running. We had no SOS or SSO, sanitary sewer overflows on the sewer system. We have four mobile generators, small generators that we use VFDs for, that we can actually run three-phase motors. So we use them on the sewer lift stations. We had them on trucks and the back pickup trucks, moved them around station to station, hardwired them, pumped all the sewer down so we never had no overflows. And we continually had them making the rounds there. So, I mean, the emergency response is very beneficial to the utilities, and we're the first call. They don't call Adam. They don't call the health department. They don't call ADEQ. They call Arkansas Rural Water, and it works.
Mayor Gray, I can, just from years of hearing testimony and always being on water, I can sympathize, you know, with your the situation you're in as far as your community. And I don't know if you're a Republican or Democrat or whatever, I could care less.
Doesn't matter at the local level.
Well, exactly.
Really,
but I can tell you, you know, I'm thinking of a community in Arkansas with a good friend running the community, working very, very hard, really doing much the same things you've done. And is kind of the poster child for getting on the stick. He's happens to be a liberal Democrat, so there's no rhyme or reason this thing. I mean, it's just communities in general. But there is a finite amount of money, and we do have to be wise and use some common sense as to, again, you know, this final part that you are lacking that costs $300 million. We have had testimony from the person that runs the water unit in greater Washington, and they've, I think, spent $1 billion, and don't hold me exactly responsible, but $1 billion, they've ratcheted down. They've done a great job, and the taxpayers' rates have gone up dramatically. They're wanting, I think, another $1 billion to ratchet down this small amount, which everyone agrees would not make any difference in the quality of the river. So, you know, if you spend a lot of money, you know, relatively speaking, you wouldn't need to spend $1 billion. But just think what you could do with, you know, some of the greenery that you're doing, not only to help the wildlife, but also just the quality of life in our communities and, you know, the adjacent things. So, again, we appreciate your story, and we'll go now to Senator Duckworth.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just had one final question. I wanted to ask Mr. Sternberg to elaborate a little bit on how the circuit riders perform in emergency situation, kind of elaborate on what we talked about just now, but in terms of helping, do they or do they not help with coordinating with local agencies and other federal agencies in the event of an emergency? How does that get integrated together, and how do you see that happening on the ground when there's an emergency and you have to respond, and you've got, you know, all different levels of government and also both vertical and horizontal?
I can give you the example in Mayflower and Bologna. We're recognized as one of the emergency responders. We work with Adam. We work with Arkansas Department of Health on all public water systems. The first call we have, if we get a call from a water system with an emergency, we contact the health department, make sure they're aware of it. They ask us to provide reports back to them of our findings. They know we're going to be deployed. My field staff is in the field anyway, and they live all across the state. So normally I have somebody that can get there within an hour and a half, just because of where my staff live. But we work with all the local agencies. When we come there to the city of Mayflower, we checked in with the city of Mayflower. They're the ones that requested us there. So when they've requested us, we've come with all our equipment and our manpower. But we have the county, the OES officer, Office of Emergency Services officer there. They contact and stay in communications with the Adam at the state office. We stay in communication with the health department. If they get any requests through Adam, it goes to the health department, and then it comes to Rural Water. And we're part of ARWARN, our Arkansas Water Agency Response Network. So we work very closely with them. There's no duplication of what we're doing. So it works very well.
So they're part of your team. You talked about how it's so important to have a person that's there on the ground that, you know, that you know and trust. Do you do emergency training programs when it comes to water response, you know, emergency responses and that sort of thing? Is that something on an annual basis with all the different agencies, along with the circuit riders? Is that being done?
Yeah, actually, I am on the national level.
You're a busy man.
I know. I've got too many titles. I'm the chairman of the National Rural Water Association Emergency Response Committee. We meet at least twice a year, but we do a one-week training somewhere located throughout the nation. This year we're going to Florida. Last year we was in Louisiana, and the 3 years prior to that we did it in Lone Oak, Arkansas. So we've moved around different places, invited the other state circuit riders to come in to be trained, to continually update them on new things out there. So it's continuation of that work. In state, my staff is all trained on it. Every month they come in, they're assigned different duties to check out the generators, make sure they're maintained, making sure the load bank has been done on them. So we actually load bank those generators so we know that even if the motor's running on that generator, that doesn't mean that generator's putting out power. All our generators have multi-voltage selector switches on them. So when we pull up on site, it doesn't matter what voltage that system has, we can set it and forget it and go with it. We did it for a reason that way.
Wonderful. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You're back, Mr. Chairman.
Well, thank all of y'all for being here. Any follow-up questions will be submitted to the witnesses for response. This record will be open for 2 weeks for additional submissions. But thank you all for sharing your stories and again, commenting on the legislation before us. I think that we've demonstrated today that, this is an issue where there really is a lot of common ground. And we're going to be working very, very hard. Senator Duckworth and I had a great meeting yesterday talking about areas that we're going to be working hard to get some things done. And so with that, the meeting is adjourned. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.